I can understand it is difficult to learn within this small place. Anyhow, hope you have already written the theory. So the practical examination. One important thing about the practicals is evening session will be you are having the four sessions, of which one of the things is instruments, the second is the specimens, the third is the x-rays, and the fourth is operative surgery. Okay? So you must be already knowing some of the things. Before I came here, you are already reviewed, I think. Okay? So with which we'll start first? Which one we should
X-rays.
Okay. So there is a popular demand that we should start with X-rays. Okay. Before we start with X-rays, one important incident which I would like to tell you is all of you must have seen WhatsApps, isn't it? There are football players in the group. So whoever it is, so you must have seen one of the goal, that is, there is what is called as penalty corner. So one of the opponent player, he hits the ball. So you must have seen, actually the goalkeeper tries to defend it, but what happens is, luckily for him, it hits the goal pole. So the goalkeeper celebrates, thinking that it has not gone. And to celebrate, he leaves the goal post and goes forward. But whatever it is, the ball, by gravity or whatever the physics, we do not know, but it tries to go slowly into the goal. The person who has hit, he is surprised, but because he thought he has missed it. But the ball goes into the goal. And the person who thought he has defended, so he left the goal post and the ball goes. So why I am telling this is, the evening session is very important. Because of two reasons. One is, if you are done well, you are going to get a distinction. So don't neglect evening session. I have seen a lot of people spoiling because of the evening session. The second is, if you are gone short case and long case, there is every ample chance that if you do your evening session well, you will script. I am not talking of the average students. Average student, it doesn't matter because they usually take it. So the importance of evening session is very much, and you cannot afford to make. So let us take some X-rays are there. Hope all of you visualize there. So luckily for me, there are people who can post one after the other. Okay, so take some plain X-rays so that we can usually differentiate. Yes, the one you have picked up now, inferior. Supriya, you keep that. For one which you are holding. Okay. Remove the other things. So whenever an X-rays are kept like this, first and foremost is the description is should be done. So the position of the X-ray has to be kept properly. So position of the X-ray is, there is what is called as right side and left side. Luckily R is there, so she has kept it on the right side. Okay. So what is the X-ray they'll ask? So this is the plain X-ray. We'll go first with the plain X-ray, then we'll go to the contrasted lateral. So this is an X-ray of the abdomen. So whenever you are taking a plain X-ray of the abdomen, it is usually the upper portion of the chest and even the pelvis has to be included. So most of the X-rays of the abdomen are taken in which position?
Erect.
It is taken in erect position. So usually the position is also one of the important things. The position is AP view. It is not PA view. Whereas chest X-rays are taken in a PA view, whereas X-ray abdomen are taken as AP view. This is an X-ray abdomen, erect. So how to describe any X-rays which is being kept is, so you should tell that it is an X-ray which has been taken in an AP group plain x-ray of the abdomen. So what it is showing? Either you describe from the center to the periphery or from periphery to the center. It's very simple, isn't it? So in this x-ray, you see the spine. Are you able to see the spine? Okay. Spinal cord column should be. Yeah. So it is not placed properly. See, there is some amount of scoliosis sort of thing. Okay. So because of the pain, probably the patient will feel better. So what you start is from periphery if you come, no? So usually, normally in a plain x-ray, you will find three radiolucent shadows. In x-ray plane, we talk of these terms. One is radiolucency and another is radio opacity. So opacity is the bone which you are seeing is radio sort of thing, and the radiolucent is the black color. So normally three radiolucent areas we should see in normal x-rays. First and foremost is the fundus shadow, that is one radiolucent area. The second is at the cecal region and another is at the duodenum. So these are the three radiolucent areas we will see. Other than that, if you see, so there is a pathological. So now if you carefully see the right side lung, you see the parenchyma. Immediately below it is the diaphragm. Okay, there is a marking. Just like a mark to be moved. So that mark above white line is there, that is the fundus, that is the diaphragm. Below the diaphragm, there is a radiolucent area, that is moon shaped, that is crescent shadow. So again the same thing is there on the left side also. So left side, the same shadow is there. So this is a hollow viscous perforation. Whenever actually in peritoneal cavity there should not be any radiolucent areas. I told you already there should be only three which are fixed. But if you have this radiolucent area, you call it as there is a hollow viscous perforation. So they ask you, what are the causes for hollow viscous perforation? The common thing which we usually come across, whenever you are telling any diagnosis or anything, think of common things first. Abnormal things later. Not the rare things, okay? The first and foremost is, we have one of the important thing is a DU perforation, where there can be a radiolucent areas, okay? Hollow viscous perforation which causes. So gastric perforation, so that is also one of the things. Ileal perforation. So comparatively to appendicular perforation, the duodenal perforation is more. That is 80% of the duodenal perforations will have. Whereas appendicular perforations only 20% will have. Though appendix perforates, because it is lower down, it doesn't. So whereas colon perforations also it will show. One of the common causes of any radiolucent areas sometimes is post-operative. Suppose you take the x-ray after the second day or third day, already opened the abdomen. So again, it takes time to gas to get absorbed. After a pneumoperitoneum for infertility and other things where they do a laparoscopy and other things where there is a possibility of gas in the abdomen. So that is called as pneumoperitoneum. Is that clear? Any doubts or anything? So depending upon that, they will ask you how to manage and other things, a DU perforation, what you are going to do. The moment you say this is a, so you think the common thing is DU perforation, you stabilize the patient, then do a laparotomy and other things. Is that clear? Any doubts? So you should come from sites and other things. So the one which you are able to see in the right iliac fossa, cecal area. So that is a cecal shadow. So left side it is a sigmoid. So that is also a transverse colon and other things. The upper portion is the stomach shadow. Is that clear? Next plain x-ray, at least is it. Don't show again the same x-ray repeat. Okay? So keep it aside. Plain x-ray. No, don't show the contrast. Plain x-ray to finish. Yes. Read that x-ray. Now I already told you what should be done. Plain x-ray of the chest. PA view. So I told you, the two terms which we usually use is one is radiolucent and radioopaque. So usually in a chest x-ray, there are zones which are described. The upper zone, the mid zone and the lower zone. and cardiac shadow and pulmonary shadow. Okay. So now if you carefully see, is the trachea in central position or not? That is what we usually should see. If there is a pneumothorax and other things, it will push to opposite side. If it is a pleural effusion also, and in collapse, it will push to the same side. So radial lucent area and the trachea, next, that is in the center. The clavicles, they appear to be center. There are upper zone of the right side, there is radial lucent area, that is lung parenchyma is seen. Whereas mid zone and the inferior zone, there is radio opaque shadows. Whenever you have radio opaque shadows, what are the possibilities? Usually we call it as like balls there. They are like what is called as
cannonball
appearance. Whenever we have such cannonball appearances, it is usually a secondary. So they will ask you what are the sites of the primary where these cannonballs can occur. So what, where could be the primary?
Renal cell carcinoma.
One.
Renal cell carcinoma.
One is renal cell carcinoma. Any other thing? So there are few sites where usually, one of the things is you have testis, ovary. These are the sites where it can be into the pulmonary secondary. So bony secondaries they will ask. Where the bone from, usually bony secondaries if they are there.
Breast.
So they, what are the sites where? So one of the common sites is your breast.
Breast.
Okay, kidney is one of the things. Lungs.
Prostate.
One thing. Prostate. So these are the things. So usually lung secondaries are the renal cell carcinomas where you will have these things. So what you are going to do, it is only a chemotherapy for this patient. Okay? Right. Next. Finish abdomen exercises if they are there. At this time. Mnemonic for the bone secretary. So that is also the same thing. It is a chest X-ray basically, but it is also showing the pneumoperitoneum. Okay, remove. Plain X-ray body. It will. Sir, X-ray service, I can keep it in order. So we'll finish up the plain X-rays, then it becomes easy for us. So if you carefully see those X-rays, right side there is a pneumoperitoneum, okay, and lower down, that is the mid zone, if you are able to see, there are radial lucent areas. Usually, obviously, that means there is some amount of fluid. That's the reason why there are some amount of fluid level which you are able to see in that X-ray. But what we can suspect in this case is there is already a perforation and with peritonitis. So if there is a peritonitis, the fluid will get collected, the bowel do not go for peristalsis and other things, and it causes some intestinal obstruction. So it is taken as a plain x-ray of the upper portion of the abdomen, so which is showing the pneumoperitoneum. The same patient, the x-ray, the adjacent x-ray is, that is some amount in the mid zone of the abdomen, there are radiolucent areas which clearly shows that there is a some amount of intestinal obstruction. Okay. The other x-ray which you are able to see on the left side, that is an x-ray of the abdomen. So I told you, you forget about the diaphragms here. The diaphragm here below it, there is no pneumoperitoneum. Are you able to visualize? Okay. But in the center of the abdomen, there is gross dilatation of the radiolucent areas. So the thumb size is also very important. So if it is a small bowl or anything, the thumb size will be there to show that there could be some intestinal obstruction. If it is more than that, and if it is showing ulcerations and other things, usually we think it could be a large bowl. The position, whether it is a small bowl or a large bowl, depends upon the x-ray where it is, the film where it is there. That is, if the radiolucent area is occupied the central portion of the x-ray, that means it is a small bowl. If it is confined only to the periphery, then it is a large bowl. So this one, whether we should take into a large bowl obstruction or a small bowl. If you carefully see, there are no ulcerations. It is only a smooth dilatation. So smooth dilatation shows it is only a small bowl dilatation. Is that clear? So this is showing an intestinal obstruction. Okay? So that is a plain x-ray of the abdomen which is showing small bowl dilatation. So probably an intestinal obstruction. So they may ask you, what are the causes for intestinal obstruction? What is the, so I told you again, we should always talk of the common things. What are the causes for small intestinal obstruction? First and foremost is intestinal adhesions. Because we are all, not only God creates some diseases, we also create iatrogenic. So we make incisions, no? So first and foremost is adhesions, or the one of the causes for obstruction. Then you have hernias, that is obstructions and other things. Then other thing, suppose there is a large bowel obstruction which you are talking about is a volvulus or anything, that is a twisting of the bowl and other things, which shows a large bowel obstruction. Okay, remove that, keep the another x-ray. So I was talking about the radiolucent areas in the abdomen. If you carefully see, some shadows are there. Only the three are the common shadows, but here some amounts of more are there. That is four or five. If there is any intestinal obstruction, so they will ask you, what should be done for an intestinal obstruction? So most of the times intestinal obstruction, it is a conservative management which we put. We put a rice tube, aspirate the fluid, and we give an enema and measure the gut. So usually intestinal obstruction will present with the following things. That is, the patient will have
pain,
vomitings, they will have obstipation and distension of the abdomen. So if it gets relieved, then it is only a conservative man. If it doesn't, and if it increases girth and other things, then we need to operate. So that is also showing some amount of radiolucent areas, which are only three on the left side. So it is only a intestinal obstruction. We have to further take the x-rays. Okay, next. So they don't keep such x-ray. Luckily for you, in the exam, they keep the classical. That is one of the things is the pneumoperitoneum, which I told you, intestinal obstruction, which I told you. Then this is a very good x-ray. So what is there in that? So usually this is an x-ray of the chest, isn't it? All of you are sure that it is x-ray of the chest? So only the upper portion of the abdomen is seen. Right side, if you carefully see, the mid zone